So real quickly, last session, okay, that was the most important session. So if you missed that, I recommend you go watch it. But so we reviewed this, the covenants we had, the final covenant. And so if you look at your chart, if one of you is missing a chart, I have it. So see me after class. Okay. So now if you look at your chart, timeline. So you have at the top of your chart, if you look at Genesis, the early world, so you've got one holy couple, right? So there they give the covenant form. If you have your yellow, did you bring your yellow sheet to that level? The covenant form, see at the top, your chart, they give the covenant form. Okay. So the first is marriage, one holy couple, right? And then one holy family, household. Family is a household. I just want you to see how this ties together. Okay. Then the third covenant with Abraham. Do you see it at the top, one holy tribe? Okay. Where it has a star. So there is something. The yellow sheep tribe. Then you go to Moses, and that is in Exodus, one holy nation. So you've got nation, it's the covenant form. And then, let's see, you have to flip over to a kingdom. Royal kingdom, one holy kingdom, and so the covenant form is kingdom. That's the fifth covenant. And then if you, then you have to go all the way to church, Luke, just to the right of Luke, and you have the covenant form is one holy Catholic and apostolic church, just like we say in the Creed, right? And so the covenant form is the Catholic Church. So all of salvation history, the whole of the scriptures is aiming towards the church. Also aiming to a particular covenant sign. So if you have your yellow sheet, right, what is that covenant sign? Eucharist, the Eucharistic sacrament. So all of Scripture culminates in Christ, okay? And he is the new covenant, remember from last week? Christ is the new covenant. But the covenant form is the church, which is the mystical body. And the covenant sign is the Eucharist, which is the sacramental body of Christ. You see that? Okay. Really important you get that, which is why the last class was so important. So it sort of culminates in that last class. Okay. Good. So let's begin with tonight's lesson here. Session 21, Acts 1, 1 to 8. The theme of the book of Acts is the kingdom of God. Okay, that is the theme. This can be seen in that St. Luke, who is the instrumental author of Acts. Do you know what I mean by instrumental author? So you have the he is the instrument. Dorn is writing with his pen. Okay, so who is writing that? Is it Dorn or is it the pen? Dorn is the principal author, right? He makes it happen. But the pen is the instrument, right? So who is the author? Who is writing it? Is it the pen or Dorn? Both. But the one is principal author, the other is instrumental author, right? So it is with Scripture, so with the the books of Scripture, who is the principal author? The Holy Spirit. And who is the instrumental author? It depends. So with the Gospel of Luke, it was St. Luke. And with Acts, it is St. Luke. Other writings, it is St. Paul, or whomever was the instrumental author. So St. Luke is the instrumental author. Okay, this can be seen in that St. Luke, who is the instrumental author of Acts, used the literary device called an inclusio, by which a particular theme or topic begins and ends a letter or book. So, for example, in the letter to the Romans, St. Paul, the first sentence and the last sentence of the letter, it uses a phrase, the obedience of faith. That is, it sandwiches the whole letter. The obedience of faith, that is the theme of Romans. What does that mean? The faith that is obedience, the faith that obeys. And this is the your ongoing justification, how you are saved. Obedient faith, right? Not just an intellectual faith, not just a knowing, but a faith that manifests itself in works of charity, obeying the commandments, etc. The obedience of faith, the faith that is obedience, that is the inclusio in Romans, and that is the theme of Romans. But here in Acts, you see similar. Okay. Specifically, at the beginning of Acts, St. Luke refers to Christ having appeared to his disciples during the 40 days prior to his ascension, speaking of the kingdom of God. So that's in the first sentence, Acts 1:3. While at the ending of Acts, St. Luke refers to St. Paul, who was under house arrest in Rome, preaching the kingdom of God. There is your inclusio. The kingdom of God is the theme of Acts. Okay. Next bullet. Recall that the kingdom of God is the kingdom of David brought to fulfillment. In this kingdom, Jesus, who following his ascension, reigns eternally from his kingly throne at the right hand of the eternal Father in the heavenly sanctuary. So this Jesus is not only the Son of David in his human nature, but also the second person of the Most Holy Trinity in his divine nature, as he is the man-God or God-man. So let me try to unpack that. Okay. So, oh my. Okay, yeah, that is a long sentence. Semicolons and periods are expensive. Okay, so let's go back to the in this kingdom, the second sentence there in the second bullet. In this kingdom, Jesus, who following his ascension, so the ascension was 40 days after the resurrection, right? So Ascension Thursday is the 40th day, right? And a dynamic of the ascension is that he ascends into heaven, where he reigns as Christ the King for all eternity from the heavenly sanctuary. Okay, now, this you might see this on the final exam. Is Jesus a human person? No. He is a divine person. Does he have it? So he has a divine nature. He has a human nature, but he's not a human person. Mary, for example, is a human person. You are human persons. See, Gabriel is an angelic person. See, Raphael is an angelic person. Jesus is a divine person. Okay? So you cannot be both a divine person and a human person. You can be a divine person with a divine nature and take upon yourself a human nature, as he did. But he's not a human person. He has a human nature, but he's a divine person. Does that make sense? Okay. It's important. Okay. Okay. It's a mystery, ultimately. Okay, but so, boy, I get the feeling you all are going to fail the final exam. Okay. So, okay. But that's a trick question. Okay. But he is a divine person. Second person of the Most Holy Trinity. Okay. Now, he took upon himself a human nature. Next bullet. Also recall that the kingdom of God / kingdom of David is the church, in which there is a king, King is Christ. Remember this typology from the Old Testament. So, in which there is a king, Christ, a Gebirah, Holy Virgin. So Gebirah is the queen mother, right? And an Al-Halayit, so the prime minister, the Pope, right? And thus, the theme of Acts is the church, beginning with her birthday at Pentecost. So the kingdom of God equals kingdom of David equals church. Three ways of saying the same thing. Does that kind of make sense? Okay. Next bullet. Though somewhat of a simplification, Acts can be divided into two basic sections, with Acts 1-12 describing the ministry of St. Peter, Acts 13-28 describing the ministry of St. Paul, who was accompanied on some of his missionary journeys by St. Luke, who is the instrumental author of Acts. So St. Luke is an eyewitness to much of this. Okay. Next bullet. When the apostles ask when the kingdom will be restored to Israel, Christ refers to how it will be restored. Okay, so he kind of ignores that question. It's not your business. Okay. How it will be restored. Precisely, the kingdom will be restored to Israel through the preaching ministry of the apostles, as can be seen by the sequence of Jerusalem to Judea to Samaria to the ends of the earth. Okay. So the kingdom will be restored through the This was a theological roadmap of the kingdom of Israel under King David at its height, with Jerusalem as David's capital, Judea as the land of David's tribe. Remember, Jerusalem is in Judea. Samaria as the land of the 10 northern tribes of David's nation. Remember, Samaria was the capital of the northern kingdom. And the ends of the earth as the lands of the Gentiles who were David's vassals. So that was the kingdom of Israel at its height, right? Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, to the ends of the earth. And so this is what they ask. They say, when will it be restored, this kingdom? This also indicates the structure of Acts, which follows the sequence of Jerusalem, so Acts 1 to 7, Judea and Samaria, Acts 8, and the ends of the earth, Acts 9 to 28, which is the mission to the Gentiles, the nations, beginning with the conversion of Saul / Paul, who will be the apostle to the Gentiles, and ending with Paul preaching in Rome, which is the capital of the Gentile world. Okay. Next bullet. After commissioning the apostles as his royal emissaries, Christ ascends to heaven, where he sits enthroned at the right hand of the eternal Father, thus beginning his kingly reign over the entire earth, the kingdom / church. Right? The kingdom is the church. And you see that again with this typology. Who is the king? Christ the king. Who is the Kabira, the Holy Virgin? Who is the prime minister, the Pope? You see that structure. The kingdom of God, the kingdom of David, it is the church. And the apostles are the royal emissaries. And we are the royal subjects. And, you know, ultimately we will be judged based on whether we faithfully served and obeyed Christ the King. If you live in a kingly realm, you are subject to the King. Now, if you act like a rogue and a rebel in that kingly realm, you will pay for it. So when we are judged by Christ the King based on how we served and obeyed him in his kingly realm. Okay. Next bullet. Pentecost is a reversal of Babel. So remember from Genesis 11. At Pentecost, the people are amazed. Just real quickly, so before I get into this, remember I said way back, I said, if you do not read the Old Testament, then you really cannot understand the New Testament very well. We see that with the typology, the kingdom is the church. You see it here with Pentecost, Babel, the relation of it. Okay. Yeah. It's scripture is like a novel, you know, if you just pick up the New Testament, read the New Testament, you're just reading like, say you've got a 25-chapter novel. You're just reading like the last three chapters and you think you know the book. You know how it ends, and you know some. But you really haven't got it, you know? And you would have no sense of the covenantal structure and how it all culminates in Christ, or specifically in his mystical body, the church, in his sacramental body, the Eucharist, right? You would totally miss these things. If you not have a grasp of the Old Testament, you just know the last three chapters and think you know more than you know. Okay, so the last bullet there. Pentecost, Acts 2, is a reversal of Babel. At Pentecost, the people are amazed and perplexed because they can understand the apostles' preaching. This just begs a joke, I know. You're amazed and perplexed because you can understand what the priest is saying in the homily. You know? Pentecost, the people are amazed and perplexed because they can understand the apostles' preaching. Even though they come from all parts of the known world. Okay? In contrast, at Babel, the people were perplexed because they could not understand what each other was saying. Right? So, the languages served to divide. At Pentecost, the language unites. Essentially, the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Christ, the Holy Spirit is the Spirit of God. Okay, you can say the Spirit of Christ. Christ is God. Second person of the Most Holy Trinity. Essentially, the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of Christ, overcomes the division caused by sin, unifying mankind in his kingdom/church through the preaching ministry of the apostles. Okay, so again, the kingdom is restored through the preaching ministry of the apostles, and we see a foreshadowing of this at Pentecost. You have, because Pentecost occurs, there's a holy day in Jerusalem, and you have people from all over the world who have to pilgrimage to Jerusalem for Pentecost. So you have people from all over the world, they speak all these different languages, and this is a foreshadowing of the preaching ministry of the apostles bringing the peoples of the world into the church, into the kingdom. Does that make sense? Okay. Next bullet. Following Pentecost, the Spirit-inspired preaching of St. Peter causes the crowd to be cut to the heart. This is an example of prevenient grace. Okay, so... this is a Latin word, prevenient. Venio is come. I'm trying to think what word you might know. Well, anyway, venio is come. Pre is before, so it's grace that comes before. Okay. This is an example of prevenient grace. Moving an unbeliever to faith. Okay, so God sends this grace into the person's life to inspire the person to convert the heart of the person to have faith. That's all it means, prevenient grace. Okay. This is an example of prevenient grace. So prevenient grace would be an example like, okay, so you have a person in mortal sin, but God sends prevenient grace to inspire the person to go to confession and be restored to sanctifying grace. Okay? Or it might be a heathen who has no faith in God or is involved in idolatry or something, some heathen. That's a word we don't quite hear anymore. It's a great word. Some heathen, and the heathen is sent by the example of the prevenient grace. Okay. Okay. This is an example of prevenient grace moving an unbeliever to faith, like the heathen, these heathens. Or, in this case, those who are not believing in Christ, these Jews who have not accepted the Messiah King. Okay, this is an example of prevenient grace moving an unbeliever to faith, expressed by repentance, which then leads to the sacrament of faith, which is baptism, by which one receives sanctifying grace, by which one receives the Holy Spirit. So let me try to unpack that. Okay. I wrote this like a week and a half ago, and I'm thinking, what the heck am I saying? Okay. It made sense when I wrote it. Okay, I just haven't looked at it for a while. Okay. So you have, this prevenient grace, it moves the heart to believe in Christ, to believe that Christ is the Messiah King, to believe that Christ is God. And so this prevenient grace, how is it expressed? Well, let me read this to you, Acts 2:38. This would make more sense. 2:37. Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart, and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, "Brethren, what shall we do?" Right, they're cut to the heart, so the Lord moved their heart by prevenient grace. "Brethren, so what shall we do?" And Peter said to them, "Repent and be baptized." He doesn't say make an altar call. Okay? He doesn't say that. He doesn't say just accept Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. He doesn't say that. What did he say? And Peter said to them, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins. And you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit." Okay? Just telling you, that's the Bible way. Okay? So the Bible way is repent and be baptized. Okay, so you have this prevenient grace moves you to believe in Christ, and so what do you do? Repent! It's expressed by repentance. And be baptized. Okay? So faith and baptism. This is essential, strictly speaking, for salvation. Faith and baptism. Right? Baptism is the sacrament of faith. It is an expression of your faith. And through baptism, the Holy Spirit is conferred to your soul. Grace, sanctifying grace, is conferred to your soul. And by grace, you are saved. Without the Holy Spirit in your soul, without the Spirit of God in your soul, how can you expect to live the life of God in heaven? You cannot. Right? Does that kind of make sense? So faith and baptism, this is essential for salvation. And through faith and baptism, you're given sanctifying grace, you're given the Holy Spirit. And so with babies, now with an adult convert, okay? So you have this heathen, right? This adult heathen. And the heathen converts by this prevenient grace, moves his heart, he hears the preaching of St. Peter. Maybe it's this Roman soldier. And it moves his heart by this prevenient grace, and what does he do? Repents and is baptized. So he moves. moves his heart to faith, faith, and baptism, right? And so with the child, so we baptize the child, the faith of the parents is imputed to the child, okay? And you can even, with theological speculation, and, you know, to the stillborns, you know, that you know that the parents have intentionality to bring the child to baptism if the child is born, but the child dies. You can speculate that it is a type of baptism of desire, whereby God will give the grace, the sanctifying grace of baptism, in an extraordinary way, because the faith of the parents is imputed to the child. Okay. Does that kind of make sense? Okay. Next bullet. After baptism, these early Christians steadfastly held to the apostles' teaching, to fellowship, to the breaking of the bread, and to the prayers. So that, Acts 2:42, that is a very important sentence in Acts. Specifically, they held to doctrinal catechesis, the apostles' teaching, right? CCD classes, RCA classes, these kind of Bible studies, right? Doctrinal catechesis. They held to interpersonal communion and support fellowship. That too here. They held to the celebration of the Eucharistic liturgy, the breaking of the bread. We talked last time that the earliest term for the Mass is the breaking of the bread. So when you see this in Acts, and you see it three times in Acts, you see it in Luke, right? At the end of Luke, breaking of the bread is the Mass, it is the Eucharistic liturgy. The Mass is a later term. It comes on. It's only used in the Western Church because the Western Church is the only church that uses Latin. The Greeks do not use it, you know. The Greek speaking, they use the term Eucharistic liturgy. Okay, that's an older term. But even older than that is the breaking of the bread. So the breaking of the bread is the first term for this. And then later, Greek became the language of the known world, right? And so then Eucharistic liturgy becomes the predominant term. And then later, Latin becomes the dominant language in the West. And so the Mass, from Misa, becomes the dominant term. So whatever you call it, Mass, Eucharistic liturgy, breaking of the bread, it is the same act of worship. So they devote themselves to the Mass. We do that too, don't we? This is the biblical way. The biblical way is they held to the celebration of the Eucharistic liturgy. This is what the early Christians did. This is what we do. This is what Christians ought to do. That is how Christians worship. The breaking of the bread, the Eucharistic liturgy, the Mass, whatever you want to call it, that is Christian worship. That is the only supernatural worship. All other worship is natural worship. Only the Eucharistic liturgy is supernatural worship because you participate in the heavenly worship. So the silliness of you ever hear, I don't go to Mass on Sunday, I just go out to the woods, right? You see it all the time, I bet, on Sunday, you see people praying in the woods, but that just is silly besides, because you cannot enter into the supernatural worship, into the heavenly worship, unless you enter into the Eucharistic liturgy. Now, if you happen to have a ministerial priest from the Catholic Church offering Mass in the woods, that would be different. okay, then I stand correct. Okay. But, you know, it happens, and God, you know, so you have priests that like to go camping, and they take a vacation weekend, and they have a mass in the woods, but that is the exception. Okay. Okay, then the last sentence, they held to praise and petitions to the prayers. So we do that too, don't we? Just like the early Christians. They copy us. Okay. The apostles and the church today and for all times preaches salvation only in and through Jesus, whose very name means salvation or God saves. Right? So this name Jesus, we've discussed this, that's the Greek, the Hebrew is Joshua, the Aramaic is Yeshua, and the Latin is Yesu, right? Whichever language, it means salvation. Or you could translate it God saves, which identifies who he is and what he does. God, he is God, and he's Savior. So let me start that sentence again. The apostles and the church today for all times preaches salvation only in and through Jesus, whose very name means salvation or God saves. And St. Peter said, and there is salvation in no one else. For there is no other name under heaven given among men by which we must be saved. Acts 4:12. Thus, there is salvation only in and through the person of Christ, who alone is Savior. Right, you can say it another way. No one comes to the Father except through me. Jesus said that, right? No one comes to the Father except through Christ. He is the only Savior. There is not salvation in these other religions. This is partly why we should have this motivation to spread the faith, so that they can go to heaven too. Right? This is why he gives the Great Commission: go and baptize, go into the world and baptize, making disciples, so the heathens too can go to heaven. There is no salvation in Muhammad. There is no salvation in Islam. There is no salvation any longer in Judaism. There is no salvation in Hinduism. There is salvation only in Christ and in his church. Next bullet. Foremost among the persecutors of the first Christians were those Jews who persisted in their obstinate rejection of Christ. If you persist in your rejection of Christ, you will not be saved. The lightning rod for this violent persecution is Stephen, deacon and martyr, who delivered a politically incorrect sermon, lambasting the unbelievers as stiff-necked, uncircumcised in heart and ears, and always resisting the Holy Spirit. That is a specifically Jewish insult. Uncircumcised in heart and ears. I bet nobody has ever said that to you. You know, it's like, you are the son of a motherless goat. You know, like, wait, I gotta process that, you know? What movie was that from? That was the Three Amigos. You son of a motherless goat. You know, I gotta think that through. I think I'm being insulted. You know? Uncircumcised in heart and ears. I think that's an insult. I'm just not really sure. I'm not really sure. Anyway. Those are the best insults when the person's like, okay. But they got it and they didn't like it. Okay. And Stephen was about to be stoned to death for preaching the gospel. He saw a vision into heaven with Jesus standing at the right hand of the eternal Father. Did that get your attention? It should have. So if you went to Mass tonight, we prayed the Gloria because it was the special feast day, the visitation. And it's reference to Christ seated at the right hand of the eternal Father, as we say in the Creed, seated, right? And then later in the book of Acts, towards the end, the last chapter, it refers to Christ seated at the right hand of the Father. And then it says standing. Was that your, like, is that a typo? Yeah. No, it's not a typo. Okay. So, let me read that sentence again. As Stephen was about to be stoned to death for preaching the gospel, he saw a vision into heaven with Jesus standing at the right hand of the eternal Father. Note that Christ is standing rather than sitting in honor of his faithful martyr, Stephen. As kings used to get off of their thrones to honor someone coming into his throne room. Wow. That would be, you know, at the end of your life, that, you know, to have that honor, if you so well served Christ the King, that you would stand as you enter into heaven as a sign of respect. Wow. He does that for Stephen. So remember, the king is the same in the same dynamic he would in the Old Testament. We saw with the king would stand when his mother, the Gebirah, enters. But there's a little more. Not only would he stand for her, but what else would he do? That he would do for nobody else. Wow, somebody said it. Such is the respect of the king for the Gebirah. So yes, he stands for Stephen. Wow. Next bullet. Stephen's martyrdom unleashes a wave of violent persecution against the Christians. Always, of course, you know who is instigating. Always. You know, how much time do I have? Well, just real quickly, you know, demons, angels and demons. Well, I don't know if that's a rabbit hole. But anyway, okay. Stephen's martyrdom unleashes a wave of violent persecution against the Christians, forcing them out of Jerusalem. However, God worked it for the good as it forced the apostles to begin ministering in Samaria and to the ends of the earth for the spreading of the kingdom/church. Okay, God bless you. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.